Welcome to worship today. It's lovely to have you here in the house of the Lord as we worship and sing praises and glorify our great and glorious God. Our call to worship can be seen on the screen. We step off the streets, away from the places of work, shopping malls, billboards, and new broadcasts to stand before the living God. We turn away from the world and the patterns of power that too often hurt, trap, and swallow us up.
We stand before our God, God of mercy, who rescues and renews us.
We come to this sanctuary seeking the living God, maker of heaven and earth.
We present ourselves to the living God, who is
we're going to worship singing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Love and your slow to anger, your name is great.
And I believe in Jesus. I believe he is the Son of God. I believe he died and rose again. He is Lord. Maker of heaven and earth, we come from different places with our own place on the journey. Some of us have succeeded and found favour. Some of us have failed and seek reassurance. Some of us feel trapped and helpless. Some of us have escaped peril and great relief. But no matter what our experience has been, we come here today to worship you, to remind us of your power and your mercy. Replenish our courage and vision. Renew our identity as your people. Reinvigorate our holy work in this world. For our help is in you alone. You are our God and our King. And we give you thanks and praise. We give you honour and glory. We worship you this day. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, and all that he's done for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing the great hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Amen.
welcome. It's lovely to see you in the house of the Lord, and it's lovely to be back amongst you after having last week flat on my back. And I will say thank you for your prayers, and our notices can be found in our news sheet today. Is there any particularly ones we should highlight? You may know that, you know, we've had a few more hurdles to jump through in terms of COVID-19, and Margaret today is our very esteemed and highly trained COVID marshal. So she will, after the service, be keeping tabs on you to making sure that everyone follows the rules. And so, Margaret, we've got this little one. It's a pool noodle, really, but, you know, it's 1.5 metres. So, you know, when we're having coffee after church, you know, oh, better make sure we don't knock off the candle there. you know, 1.5 metres is a fair old whack of space. You know, they want us to make sure that we follow all the rules. The other thing is, I noticed when we're having coffee, we're meant to be seated. So when you grab your coffee, sit down. And when we use hand sanitizer, we're meant to use hand sanitizer on the way in and on the way out. So I learned a few things this week about... So if anyone is, you know, feels too close to you, you can come and, you know, you could wave this and maybe not whack them with it, because, you know, that might be, you know, but yes. So we'll just, how about we put this on the organ and we can just remind ourselves. Not that, I'm sure we follow all the rules, yes. Shoeboxes, yes. June's collecting stuff for shoeboxes, so bring your stuff to the church, and we can and we'll make sure we can get that to June for the children overseas who don't receive any presents. Okay, we're going to pray. Let's pray. God of mercy and hope, it is hard to hold on to hope. We see people handed over as food for the enemy's teeth, or as prey for the hunter's traps. Sometimes we are the food and the prey. Sometimes we are the enemy and the hunter. Sometimes we're merely bystanders, too afraid or powerless to act as we should. Forgive us, O God, when we accept things as they are. Maker of heaven and earth, giver of hope, saviour of the distressed, fill our imaginations and hearts with your splendid vision for our world. Transform and renew our minds, that we may discern what is good and pleasing to you. In this world you love so deeply, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing again, Far and Near.
oceans roar, nature sings, for he comes to judge the earth in righteousness and in his truth. Say it loud, say it strong, tell the world what God has done. Say it loud, praise his name.
Pat's going to come and read to us from the scriptures.
Psalm 124. What if the Lord had not been on our side? Answer, O Israel. If the Lord had not been on our side when our enemies attacked us, then they would have swallowed us alive in their furious anger against us. Then the flood would have carried us away, the water would have covered us, the raging torrent would have drowned us. Let us thank the Lord who has not let our enemies destroy us. We have escaped like a bird from a hunter's trap. The trap is broken and we are free. Our help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth.
Let's come before our God with our prayers for our world. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come with our prayers and that you're already answering them as we pray. So Father, we pray this morning especially for those we know who are sick and unwell. We ask, Lord, for your blessings on them, your encouragement, that you will touch them with your healing hand, heal them and restore them. Father, we pray for those in our community who are far from you. We ask, Lord, that you will draw them closer to you and that they will come to know you as their Lord and Saviour. We pray for those who are without hope, without peace. Father, give them hope, give them courage. We pray for those who are isolated in their homes because of COVID-19. We ask, Lord, that you will give them your grace at this time. Father, we pray for communities at the border who are struggling under restrictions. Those who can't go to work, those who can't open their businesses. Father, we ask, Lord, that you'll be with them and bless them in this time. Father, we pray for those who are unemployed. We ask, Lord, that you will provide employment. For those places where there is war and strife, Lord, we ask that you'll come and bring your peace. We pray for your church too, Lord, that you will enable us during these times to find new ways to connect with people in our community. We pray, Lord, that you'll continue to bless us and encourage us as we do ministry here, which spreads out not only in Coonalike Gardens, but right across our suburbs, this city, our nation, and our world. Father, may you continue to bless us so that we can be a blessing to all others. And together we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in a time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Amen. Pat's going to come and read to us from the Gospels.
Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 20. Jesus went to the territory near the town of Caesarea Philippi, where he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" "Some say John the Baptist," they answered. "Others say Elijah," while others say Jeremiah or some other prophet. "What about you?" he asked them. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." "Good for you, Simon, son of John," answered Jesus, "for this truth did not come from you, from any human being, but it was given to you directly by my Father in heaven. And so I tell you, Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock foundation I will build my church, and not even death will ever be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." Then Jesus ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord.
We're going to sing again, "All Praise to Our Redeeming Lord." Today you can place up the bowl at the back of the church as you leave. But why don't we pray for our offerings? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask, Lord, that you will come and bless these gifts, because you are the maker of heaven and earth. You help us in the midst of need and danger. And we ask, Lord, that you'll bless these gifts, that they may find their way to those who are hopeless and without resources. And may our gifts be a sign of your hope and your love. And may they find people to help find their way to safety in you. So, Father, bless these gifts, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, our reading today is, it's all about Jesus wanting to know how people described him. So Jesus, in our reading, he's moved away from Galilee, where they were mainly Jews, into an area of non-Jews. And so he asks them, he says to his disciples, "Who do the people say that I am?" And they answered, "Well, some say you're John the Baptist, who's come back to life. Others say that you are the great prophet Elijah. Others still say the prophet Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets." And they said this because it was well known in Jewish thought that a great prophet would arise. And they all had a sense that Jesus is someone special. But all those descriptions fall short of who Jesus really is. So Jesus then presses his disciples further. He takes them out of the abstract about what other people say about him, and he says that he makes it personal by directing the question to themselves, putting them on the spot as to who they believe Jesus really is. And I think Jesus wasn't really testing them, but rather Jesus wanted to find out just how far they had come. Did disciples really get it yet? Or did Jesus have some more work to do in convincing them of what was the truth? Where were they on their faith journey? You know, the scriptures don't say that there was deadly silence. But I imagine rather for a moment they would have paused and there's a silence there. And then Peter, as normal, would speak for the group when there was silence. And he steps forward as their unannounced spokesman, really. And he declares, he says, "Jesus, you are the Christ." You know, the word Christ comes from the Greek word Christos, and it means anointed one. And so in the days of Jesus, it meant a kingly figure who would come like David and who would triumph in the last days. And all of Israel's enemies will be defeated. The Christ would be the one who would come and bring light and hope to the whole of Israel. And so this description of Peter is the first time someone describes Jesus in this way. But not only does Peter describe Jesus as the Christ, he goes further to express Jesus' identity. He says, "You are the Son of the living God." You know, this had special meaning to the people of Caesarea Philippi, the area where they were. It's an area well known for the worship of Baal and Pan and Caesar. In other words, Jesus wasn't just one of the mythical superstitious figures. He wasn't like one of the other gods of his time, but rather that he belonged to the living God. And as a son, he had a unique relationship with the Creator. You know, it also points back to King David's line when it was prophesied that a Savior would be a son. And so, it's interesting, isn't it? This was Peter. "You are the Christ, the Son of God." This is the same Peter who goes on to disown Jesus, not once but three times on the night when Jesus was arrested. But what's clear here is that Peter knows exactly who Jesus is. And throughout Jesus' life, he continually laid claim that he had a special relationship with his Father. And the disciples had seen this and they had experienced it. Jesus wasn't just pointing to God like all the other rabbis did. Everyone who heard him and saw him and had an experience of Jesus could see that he spoke and taught with authority, an authority which none of the other religious leaders had. Jesus was pointing the way to God through himself. And so we're reminded of the words that Jesus says. He says, "I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the light of the world. I am the gate. I am the true vine. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life." You know, it was teaching that was unheard of before. And so the gospel writer here, Matthew, is declaring to all who Jesus really is, that there could be no confusion, that Jesus really was the Son of God. And yes, he was fully human, but he was also fully divine as well. But you know, Jesus doesn't finish there. He goes on and says to Peter, he says, Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock foundation I will build my church, and not even death will be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. And in other words, Jesus is saying to Peter, be encouraged, because I will use you to build my church on solid rock. You are solid rock, and nothing will be able to destroy the church on which I build. You know, many people have come throughout the ages to try and destroy the church, but every time the church has come out stronger than before. And those words speak to us as well. You know, we can be encouraged, because as followers of Jesus, the keys to the kingdom of heaven has been given to us as well, to you and to me. And our calling is to give people access through the kingdom, access to the kingdom through the power of Jesus' name. And you know, God wants us to be part of his incredible team and to build his kingdom and his church. And he's given us the same authority, his authority. And in the name of Jesus, we can pray for healing, because God has given us the power to do that. We can see miracles happen because of the power that God has given to us. We can see situations change because God has given us the power to change situations, because we believe in the name of Jesus. And so never forget that Jesus wants to use you, that you were born for such a time as this, and God has put you in this place, in this age, in this suburb, and this church for a reason. Because God wants to build his church through you. And whatever God calls you to, you can be assured that you can succeed. So as a church, we want to help you fulfill your destiny and your purpose. Because with Jesus, nothing will be able to stop you, not even the gates of hell. And so the question Jesus asked his disciples all those years ago in the Middle East is the same question Jesus asks of us today. It's a question each and every one of us have to make. And that is, who do you say Jesus is? You know, each of us, we have to search our inner selves for the answer in our hearts. And at some point, we have to make sure we make a decision. Jesus' entire life stands and falls on his claim to be God. So who do you say Jesus is? Everyone has their own view. Time magazine named Jesus as the most influential person who ever lived. But is that enough? Does it really describe who Jesus is? Peter's declaration of you are the Christ is a description so much more than just the most influential person that ever lived. You know, Simeon in the temple, when Jesus was presented after his birth, 8 days after he was born, seems to understand best what was happening in Jesus, and that history would never be the same again. He says, "For my eyes have seen your salvation." The high priest at Jesus' trial doesn't seem to really understand who Jesus is. Because he tore his clothes in disgust when he said he was the Christ. You know, we all have to come up with an answer, just as the disciples did. Each and every one of us will be called to ask and say who Jesus is for us. You know, Bono, singer of the U2 band, says this. He says, you know, Jesus doesn't let you off the hook. The scriptures don't let you off the hook so easily. When people say, you know, good teacher, prophet, really nice guy, this is not who Jesus thought of himself. This is not how Jesus thought of himself. So you're left with a challenge. Either that Jesus was who he said he was, or he was a complete and utter nutcase. You have a choice to make. And he says, goes on to say, and I believe that Jesus was, you know, the Son of God. Is Jesus really our King? Because, you know, when we follow Jesus, it means that he calls us to be different from the world around us. Because he calls us to a higher level of intimacy in our relationships. He calls us to a higher level in our personal actions. He calls us not to get caught up with the things of this modern world, but he calls us to a higher level of love. He calls us to love him with all our might, our strength, and our soul, and everything that we have. And so God calls us to follow his lead. And he will lead us to places and situations where people in this world will not go, so that we can be his salt and light. In the end, we all have to ask that question: who is Jesus? Who is Jesus for us? And if we say that Christ is the living Lord, then we have to follow our heart and make Jesus as Lord of our lives, follow him wholeheartedly, and be different, giving everything that we have to Jesus. Because following Jesus takes everything that we have. So be encouraged. For those who follow Jesus, we have nothing to fear. For those who call Jesus as Lord, Jesus will lead us and guide us so we can have courage and faith on the journey that he has for us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for Peter's declaration all those years ago. And we thank you, Lord, that we can make the same declaration today. Lord, you are our God. You are our King. You are our Christ. You are the Son of God. And so today, Lord, we name that before you. And Lord, we give you everything that we have and we follow you. Because you have done a wonderful thing in us. And we can see the way that you have worked in us and through us, and continue to bless us. So, Father, we ask, Lord, today that you'll encourage us and walk with us on the journey of faith that we have with you. Strengthen us and bless us so that we can be a blessing to others, so that we can live the life that you want us to live, a life worthy of your calling that you have upon our lives. Lord, bless us so that we may be a blessing to others. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing again, Lord of the Years.
Lord,
and the blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.